Today we're going to talk about how to expand your character. How to approach a character the same way an improviser or an actor would. Now, two things we can do. One, skeleton approach. What you want to do is you want to gather up some ideas about who this person is, but not all of them. Game hasn't started yet. You don't know what the fuck's going to go on. Don't write a novel. By the way, don't want to read your novel. You're probably not a good writer. Sorry, I hate to break this to you, but most people aren't. It's one of the reasons being a writer is really hard, or there'd be more people making a living at it. There's lots of shit authors who get published, and there are going to be good ones who are out there who don't get published. You're probably not one. Now, this quick general background sketch will give you an idea of who your character is. What you want to do is take a couple instances in their life and build up a chain of consequences from it. Say, this thing happened compared to the other stuff that's been going on. How does this affect my character? How does this thing make me react? Did someone help to blunt it or to amplify it? For the first few sessions, treat it like it's a TV pilot. Because in pilots, sometimes characters change because they realize they haven't grown to meet what the story needs or what the ensemble needs yet. You're not better than some of these shows. The characters in Breaking Bad started off quite a bit different with the exception of Walt than they ended up being later on. You are not better than Breaking Bad. So what you want to do is you want to allow your character to have some time to grow into both the person that he or she is becoming, as well as to fit into the story and the ensemble. Now, let's say, for example, if we're doing an urban fantasy game, I kind of want to play a wizard. Why would you want to be a wizard? Because being a wizard is awesome. That's why you play urban fantasy game. Someone has to be the wizard. That's important. I'm going to be a bookworm nerd guy who was picked on all the time and was in the library, and that's how he became a wizard. Shut the fuck up, Phil. It's like so many wizards. It's way too many of them. Let's have something different. You know what? Let's branch out. Let's make this wizard the track star. Ran cross country. Good guy. Got along with a lot of people. Let's say he broke his leg one day. No, fuck it. Didn't break his leg. And he makes it into regionals. And regionals takes him to, let's say, Chicago. So he goes to Chicago. He stays with his uncle who lives up there. Discovers that his uncle is a wizard. Uncle's like, hey man, you're a good kid. You should be a wizard too. And that would be amazing. I would love to be a wizard. Teach me how to use magic.
Then did my uncle get killed because of something I did?
Shut the fuck up, Phil. It doesn't have to be tragedy. Good things can happen. We grow through joy as well as grief. So let's say that instead of like his uncle becoming some sort of demonic wizard who ends up destroying everything, maybe he's a good guy, and maybe things go well, and our track star grows up and becomes a wizard and starts to help people, and I take a couple other things throughout his life, and he has this good mentor, and he knew people, and is social, and is physically fit, and all that kind of stuff, and that could make a cool wizard. You fill in a few more things, ask some of the same questions. In this case, my uncle helped amplify those parts of me that wanted to help people, because my uncle helped people, because he's a good wizard. The fact that I got along with a lot of people meant that I have lots of social skills, that I got to meet people, I was semi-popular, still keep the athleticism. This is a character who's generally a happy-go-lucky person, which is awesome, because there's a lot of Wolverine sad mopey wannabes in gaming. And I'm tired of them. They're not as interesting as you think. That's kind of character masturbation.
I had a scene when my character is just really sad because no one understands him. And, like, Dad keeps asking him to do things that he doesn't want to do because he's a free spirit.
We can be happy. Characters are allowed to be happy. Please let them be. Now, the other thing you can do is go on the fly. If you want to focus on personality, there's actually some really cool things you can do. First of all, don't just list quirks. People are not quirks. At the beginning of a scene, before anyone said anything, I make a decision on how I want to react. And that decision, no matter what's said to me, I'm going to go with. Cool part about that is, sometimes someone gives me something that I should not have that emotional reaction to. That means I get to justify why that's happened. So if I decide at the beginning of the scene, my character's going to be angry. I don't know why. We're starting off. I want to be angry about something. We'll figure out why he's angry at first. The king looks down upon you and says, thank you so much for helping all of the orphans of the city. Why is the GM using a bad English accent? I guess we started right in the middle of shit. Okay, maybe I'm angry because one of the orphans didn't survive, and I tried really hard to make the orphan live. Every single orphan is accounted for and safe because of your actions. Okay, maybe it wasn't that one of them died. Okay, I guess that's not it. Maybe someone was involved who I was trying to catch and they escaped. And I feel real bad about that and it makes me angry because he's going to go do stuff to other orphans. If you decide on the emotion before you start, be prepared to sometimes have to switch up the reasons why it is. It feels weird to be like, can we let like a handful of orphans just die? Like, there's a lot of orphans in this city. We can lose a couple, right? Some GMs will be fine with that, but it's a weird question to ask. It's much easier to actually ask them something along the lines of, so, can I have some guy who I have a personal feud with that I was trying to capture who managed to escape? And leave it there. Don't start making up the whole backstory yet. There's just some dude that you're after. The GM might think, that sounds awesome. I got a character for that. Or if he GMs the way I do, I go, that sounds awesome. We will make up a character like that right now who will then be very important. Because some people don't understand. You can make a character up like that. And they can become the most important NPC in the game if people like them. And if they get involved in important stuff. But we're going to talk about that another time. This is what you don't want to do. Because your character's angry, don't disrupt what's happening. It's not your job, especially at the very beginning of a game, to derail everything because your character needs an extra scene. Think about it for a second. Try to figure it out. Ask some questions. By all means, ask some questions. Give ideas. Don't game with assholes who won't even entertain ideas. But think in that moment, why does this make me angry? Play the character as angry, but don't necessarily choose what it has to be yet. And if you do, like, wait for a break in the scene. Maybe ask the GM about it. Maybe it'll get worked in. Maybe it won't. Maybe you need to change it, but it'll give you an idea that this thing, whatever it was, has made me angry. Now, all I gotta do is figure out why that is. And if you keep doing things like this, particularly at the beginning, you will end up building the character, because now you have to justify what's going on. I'm going to be happy in this scene. Joe, your father's dead. Guy's kind of an asshole. I'm angry when orphans are saved, and I'm happy when my dad's dead. Let's figure out why. Maybe dad was lingering from a long and painful illness. Maybe I've now inherited everything that he has. Maybe dad's a dick. Having the wrong emotional reaction to something can be good, but don't be contrary just to be contrary. There's something to be said for deciding I'm going to be this and justify it, as opposed to, oh, I should probably be happy at this, but I'm going to be angry because I'm an asshole. And remember, it doesn't have to be angsty. Suffering does not make your character special. And one of my favorites, but this one takes a while and actually requires everybody, is what I'm going to call the Smallville method. It's a relationship map that gets built as an entire group. And I'm actually going to give you some examples you'll be able to see in this video. Because one, they're going to look really complicated, but they actually build up really organically and in a cool way. I use this with both my acting classes and my creative writing classes because it gets my students who don't usually care that much to get a whole lot of background done and not realize how much work they're doing. The important thing is, if you're using the Smallville method, one, get a copy of Smallville. Pick it up. It's worth it. One, great game. Two, the character creation can be used in any game. Just all you need to do is strip out all the mechanical aspects, though I would keep distinctions, though change them to fit, because those actually can be useful to help build your character and figure out what they're like. Most important thing, do not figure it out ahead of time. Come in with just the bare minimum idea of what you want your character to be, because if you're open to everybody else, that character is going to be very different by the time you get through it, and it's going to be better because of it. You will cooperatively create your character. Now, what you got to decide on is the scope of the game. If everyone's from the same city, just do it like normal. But if your GM has you strewn all about, like adventurers coming together from various places, you're still tying in your characters, but it's just not all in one place. Now, the way this works, the whole thing ties your characters together in ways that are really great. By the time you're done, and all throughout here, there should be stuff in a moment, You will know your characters, their relationship to each other, their relationship to a bunch of NPCs and locations that have all been built together. And you start seeing my father knew your father, or I used to date your sister. Suddenly you have characters that actually matter and who have importance in the game. And you start figuring out how do these people affect me. And that builds naturally on itself. So all like the work you would do in improv or theater where you're building up a character's relationships, that's done. By the time you get this thing finished, you've got it. Now, those are a couple ways to start creating a character. This is if you're starting off, like, first session. Either you're making those decisions as you go, filling in the stuff so that it better fits along with everybody else and grows organically, or you create it all together and it gets created organically. And in both of them, the less you kind of have nailed down as gospel beforehand, the better off your character's going to be. Characters are created through the situations and the stories that you play. Deciding who they're going to be before game one has started often leads to characters who don't necessarily fit together, and frankly, I've found not as much fun to play. Peace.